Hello, everyone. Welcome to a special episode of Visual Studio Toolbox. I'm your host, Leslie Richardson, joining you from the studio for the very first time in like 2-3 years. I don't have a sense of time anymore, so who knows. And today I'm really excited because we are going to be starting off a brand new mini series that's all about writing extensions in Visual Studio using a brand new extensibility model that the extensibility team has been working on for quite some time now. And this is my team, so I'm really excited to be sharing it with the rest of the team. So joining me today to kick things off are Tina and Bertan. Welcome, y'all.
Thanks, Thank Leslie.
So can you introduce yourselves and tell a little bit more about yourselves?
Yeah. So I'm Tina. I'm the engineering manager for Visual Studio Extensibility. And my team has been working on a new model for extensibility to make it easier to write extensions.
Hi, I'm Bertan. I'm a principal software engineer working with Tina on the Visual Studio Extensibility project.
Awesome. Cool. So, you know, extensions have been in Visual Studio for a long time, right? So we've seen a lot of cool things come out of that and helping people become more productive with whatever add-on they want to add to Visual Studio. So what is this new extensibility model all about? What's the deal?
Yeah. So before we kind of dive into the new extensibility model, I want to take a step back and kind of address the problems that we have with our current extension model, which is named VS SDK. The analogy that I always use is, imagine if you're building a house, or a gingerbread house in this case. there's kind of two models that you can go with, right? You can kind of go with their VS Codes model, which is to give you templates so you can get a house built quickly with relatively solid footing. Or you can go with the Visual Studio's current model, which is to ask you to kind of bake your own cookies, make your own frosting, measure and cut out your own shapes, and then assemble them however you like. While this is really powerful and customizable, most of the time people don't know what to do with that. So you end up with a house, you know, like the one in the picture. We want to correct that. We want to lower the barrier to entry and make it so anyone can write an extension. And these issues that we've discovered have kind of caused our ecosystem to stagnate over the years, especially if you compare that with VS Code, right? VS Code has a lot more vibrant ecosystem that's growing, and we've been, you know, somewhat consistent in the last couple of releases. The problems that we really found from an extension developer and customer's point of view is both extension developers and customers want to write and use a more reliable extension that won't crash VS or negatively affect other extensions. And more so for extension developers, a lot of them struggle to write extensions in Visual Studio because of the inconsistent APIs, because of the overwhelming architecture, and because of the large tribal knowledge that you have to obtain to do anything with it, right? And to solve these problems completely from the root, we need to start from the ground up and start over. So the truth is to make both, you know, extension reliable, performant, and simple to write, we can't just repackage the existing APIs. We need a fundamental shift.
Yeah, that makes total sense. And I love that the gingerbread house has a frowny face on it. Mm-hmm. But I can remember when I first joined the team and tried to write an extension, just having to deal with the documentation and a lot of it being out of date even, and then just having to ask everybody how to do what I thought was going to be a basic task. It was frustrating. So it's exciting that we get the rare opportunity to start from scratch, which doesn't always happen.
Yeah,
so,
yeah, for sure.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that. So what is the solution to this problem, or Visual Studio.extensibility, if you will?
Yeah, so I'm gonna show you a quick diagram. Really what we're doing is we're bringing extensions out of process. So if you see here on the left, we have a bunch of extensions that are written today using VS SDK, which is our current model. And all of these extensions run in the same process as Devon, or, you know, the process name for Visual Studio. There are a number of problems with that, right? So for example, any fundamental changes that we make to DevEnv itself, extensions have to, you know, respond to that. So for example, when we migrated from Visual Studio 2019 to Visual Studio 2022, we had a major shift in our CPU architecture. We went from x86 to AMD64 model. And with that, because extensions were running in the same process as DevEnv, every single extension had to be recompiled and use new APIs to adopt to those changes. The other thing that's that kind of limits us with writing performant code for extensions is because you're running in the same process as DevEmv, any crashes, any hangs, any mistakes that you might make your extension would affect the entire process. So it's not really constructed in a way that allows you to write a foolproof extension. So with that, we're moving extensions out of process. And I'll kind of show you why we're doing that. So first, we want to improve the extension consumer experience, right? By moving extensions out of process, it promotes a healthier Visual Studio because extensions will no longer hang or crash Visual Studio. And the other benefit of having extensions move out of process is you no longer have to restart your Visual Studio in order to install extensions, which has been a really hugely requested feature over the years from our extension consumers.
That is so exciting.
Yeah,
not having to restart.
Yeah, it's just because you run in the same setup as DevEmv, those things you cannot do. But when we're running out of process, we can absolutely do that.
Yeah, I know for me, sometimes I'm like, I don't really feel like trying out this new extension right now just because it would mean having to restart
VS
to get it set up. So
Right. Nice
to remove that little barrier of entry for
right.
a lot of people.
Right, and as an extension consumer, you can kind of see that, hey, even if I install this extension that's still in preview or beta, it's not going to crash my VS or make it all of a sudden be slow.
Right.
Yeah. The other side of that is, we want to improve our extension developer experience because without extension developers, we don't have an ecosystem. So we really need to, boost the ecosystem and make it easier and more attractive for people to write extensions. So we are, with moving it outside of DevEmv, we're basically re-architecting our entire extensibility model. So we have a clean cut from legacy concepts like Calm. We have a modern async API, and we actually, our team is now driving a consistent and intuitive way to write your APIs that our team centrally reviews and manages. So it's not like, the wild, wild west anymore where, every single team kind of determines how they want, their extension scenarios to be written.
Cool. So it's a lot more centralized
yeah.
in terms of what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
Sweet. So, Bertan, on the topic of architecture, how exactly is this new model structured?
So how are we doing this? So what we are working on when we say Visual Studio.extensibility that you're going to see being mentioned over and over again, we're talking about implementation layer on top of our RPC contracts, which are interfaces that are compatible with JSON RPC for out-of-process communication. And so what we're bringing value with Visual Studio Extensibility is we're making them easier to use in C#. We're bringing that asynchronous the contracts are async by nature because we have to go out of process, but we're making it easier to use in C#. We're bringing helper classes, we're bringing helper APIs, and we're going to be bringing a consistent experience, as Tina said, across Visual Studio features. And your code will ideally deal with Visual Studio.extensibility all the time. That's the API that you're going to see. You're not going to have to deal with RPC contracts. And underneath RPC contracts, we have our service implementation, which is these services can come from devm.exe, the Visual Studio process. They might be coming from other out-of-process components that run with Visual Studio. But you don't have to worry about that. That's where Visual Studio.extensibility brings value. So hopefully our goal is to provide that consistent, easy-to-use C# API to write extensions that work in Visual Studio. And like as you said, people will just drop them and it will run without restarting. So that's our goal.
That's great. So I mean, judging by that new structure, it seems like it's a lot easier to get into writing your first extension, not having to worry about some of those more complicated topics like the service implementation, for instance.
Yes, we're trying to hide away most of those concepts as much as possible. So as you're going to see in future sessions, writing your first extension is much easier. You don't have to know about those services. You're going to be working with asynchronous APIs. There is some cost to being out of process, but our goal is to make that as easy as possible.
Awesome. Sweet. So what do we currently have enabled today with the new model? So like if people wanted to dive in right now, what kind of extensions or features could they start writing?
Yeah, for sure. So as you can imagine, writing Visual Studio extensibility is a huge, you know, tall order. It's a little bit like boiling the ocean because we have so many extensibility points in VS SDK today. But we have to start somewhere. So what we do have today are, you know, these kind of categories of extensibility scenarios, right? So you can write a command, right? And your command can do things like insert a GUI to your file or optimize your image. So very basic, very simple extension that you can write with that. You can also do linters and formatters. So what are linters? Linters are kind of the extension or the features that that's built into IDEs or editors to tell you, hey, do you have a syntax error? Do you have a semantic error? You know, were you supposed to put the quotes around, you know, your string or, you know, things like that, right? And then formatters are, you know, things to help you structure your code according to your favorite formatting structure. So for example, if you have a JSON formatter, then you can tell it to say, hey, whether I want, you know, line breaks in between all my lines or whether I want parentheses to be on separate lines or in the same line, like those are the formatters that you can do. We also have the ability to write non-language based productivity extensions. I know that's a mouthful, but really yeah. What it means is you can write a productivity extension that does not require any interaction with the language in question. So for example, you won't be able to write a productivity extension that says, hey, I supplement C#, or it's a productivity extension for Go, right? Those are not yet enabled. But you could write a productivity extension like, Git line stage or, NuGet package reference, explorer, where it doesn't need to interact with, you know, the language in question. So things like, you know, using tool windows with a concept called remote UI, which we'll explain in a later episode. To write an extension like a stock ticker or a tic-tac-toe, those type of extensions you can write. And lastly, we have this thing called hybrid VS SDK and Visual Studio.extensibility extensions. And what that means is we acknowledge the fact that it's gonna take a while for Visual Studio extensibility to have the full feature that VS SDK offers. And while we're, you know, beefing up Visual Studio.extensibility and adding more features to it, you might want to write an extension, but you might be missing 10, 20% of the APIs that you need. So what we allow you to do is we allow you to combine Visual Studio.extensibility and VS SDK to get, you know, the 20, 10% of APIs that you don't yet have, but still be able to write an extension and package that and push it onto the marketplace. The other thing that's nice about this is if you already have an extension that's written in VS SDK and you want to try out Visual Studio.extensibility, but not all the APIs are there yet, you can migrate your extension in stages, right? And that cuts down your work, that helps you plan better, and it also helps us, right? If you discover any bugs, then we can address them early.
Awesome. So we still got a ways to go, but it's really exciting to see that we do have some major scenarios enabled that people can try out now.
For sure.
And yeah, if you want to learn more about what's coming, definitely stay tuned for the upcoming What's Next episode on Visual Studio.extensibility that we're going to be doing. So in that case, yeah, for people to just get started right now, where can people go to learn more about Visual Studio.extensibility?
Yeah, so we have our own GitHub page. All of our documentation is hosted on our own GitHub repo right now. We are in the process of potentially migrating that to learn.microsoft.com in the future. But right now, you can go to our VS Extensibility GitHub repo and get all the documentation. We also publish blog posts regularly when we have new features that are coming out. So that's a really nice way to keep track with our progress. But all of the information will be included in the description below. So feel free to go browse and, you know, let us know your feedback.
Awesome. Well,
I want to add, we also track the issues on that GitHub repo page.
Sure.
So
mm-hmm.
If you have feedback, that will be the right page to use.
Yeah, we actually read those, y'all. So
yeah.
Put in your
I replied them personally.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, I'm excited to dive into this model a lot more. So this is just the first episode, and the next couple episodes, we're gonna be talking a little bit more about what even is an extension in Visual Studio And then we're going to be doing like a deep dive into how to write certain components of an extension using different pieces of the new API. So definitely stay tuned for that. It's going to be really exciting. We're going to have a lot of different members from the Visual Studio team showcasing what they've been working on for so long, and it's really cool. So with that, stay tuned for the next set of extensibility episodes. And Tina and Vertan, thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you, Leslie.
Thank you very much.
Sweet.
Thank you.
So happy coding, y'all.